Into the country, and you need principle-centered, people-driven leaders to do that. And here you have Mr. Faris Al-Rawi. I grew up with him, and I know him to be a very ethical, moral, focused young man. He is very successful, both himself and Ms. Olivierre. And Olivierre, sorry, very fun. So without further ado, let me turn this over to Mr. Faris Al-Rawi.
Sorry, Ladies and gentlemen, she is proof that time stands still. And there's further proof because Nicole and I are supposedly the same age, which is near impossible. So you may not know this, but I actually have a twin sister. So I'm one of a twin. She's also a lawyer. She's the better looking version of the two of us. And she herself has twins. And miraculously, 10 years ago, my sister stopped aging. So she is now 10 years younger than me, and apparently Nicole shares a similar fate. So Marianne and Nicole were once the same age, but are now 10 years younger. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so very much for joining us tonight. We're gonna have Sarah Guru come and join us in a little while. She is another candidate, sister of ours in the PNM's 1 of 41. And we also have Terry Jadoonanan, who is Oropouch East, who's going to join us as well. So we're here tonight, and we asked a couple of you to disturb yourselves and to get up and go and meet each other. Some took a little while to quite do it, I was watching, and others embraced the opportunity. But it's on occasions like these that we all get the chance to interact with minds. And we have had a very positive and excellent response in our campaign over the last 5 years. You see, the PNM's campaign didn't begin when the Prime Minister announced the election on July 12th. Our campaign began the day we lost the election. In May 2010, we took a defeat which, in my opinion, we well deserved. It is my own heartfelt view that we had lost touch with people, that we had excellent policies, good ideas, but that we had failed to communicate what I call the line of sight. And Nicole will smile as somebody from the energy sector. It's a familiar term in the energy sector, where the person who is lowest on the bottom of the pyramid has the line of sight straight up to the top and knows what steps are required to get to the top. And in May 2010, we looked at ourselves and we said, listen, whilst policy may be good, you must be in constant communication with your people. It was a different time then. Trinidad and Tobago had come out in just the very initial stages of a global financial meltdown. We were introduced to the fancy word profligacy. The UNC used it all the time. They said the PNM had overheated the economy. We had spent this massive amount of money that no other government had ever spent. They said that we had built all of these things. We built Trinidad Generation Unlimited, a massive plant to feed the whole of Trinidad and Tobago. We built industrial parks. We built 26,000 homes. They said we had overheated the economy. We built what they call tall buildings. They didn't tell you that it was to put financial services complexes in there. But then, Trinidad and Tobago has seen us at work for the last 5 years. And what we did in the party was to open it up to everyone. Very particularly, our political leader, Dr. Rowley, said it is time to bring to life the next generation of the PNM. And we have been engaged in our campaigns, and you will note, right now, our younger brother, Avinash Singh, is on a platform in Karani Central, blazing away. So we are here, they are working there, Lavendale West is working, Lavendale East is working, Aruka Maloney is working, we're at work in every constituency. But we have a political leader who says, go forward and you carry your own conversations. You know what our policy is, let people know who you are. You carry the conversation. We're not hiding behind the label of one person. There isn't a Keith Rowley is popular, the entire election is about Keith Rowley. We learned that lesson in 2010. What was the lesson about in 2010? Patrick Manning. When you personify a political party in one person, think you're headed down the wrong line. Adolf Hitler learned that fate. Saddam Hussein learned that fate. When you think about it, any time you have seen a country fall or an entity fall, it has been through a sustained attack on one entity. But you didn't come to hear all of that. You came because you have burning questions and you've been very active in your participation. And we are very eager to share our views on our policies with you. And what we have done, street by street, corner by corner, as I've met so many of you, street by street, corner by corner, half a twin at a time, in some cases, you know that what we have done, each of us, is to walk each inch of our constituencies, not just to meet people, but to meet and know where they and where we live. You can't represent a constituency unless you know people's needs. Jobs, housing, unemployment, underemployment. There are many people that have 2 and 3 university degrees who can't get the level of salary or position in their enterprises that is worth their academic expenditure. There are many people who know that education is not everything. I'm half Arab, half Indian. The half Arab side of me believes in something called, the best degree is something called your BSc. Heard about a BSc? Well, in the Arab world, it means behind the store counter degree. It doesn't mean education. It means experience. And I'll give you an example of somebody with a behind the store counter degree who just made $1 billion in profit last year in Trinidad and Tobago. His name is Anthony Sabga the First. It isn't all about education, and so there are many entrepreneurs in our San Fernando West or Labre or Carony East constituencies who don't necessarily need a university degree, a shirt and a tie. What they want is the space and opportunity and footing to make something of themselves. Because we in Trinidad and Tobago, somehow we fall into this rut of being told you must be employed. Really? What about being self-employed? What about earning your own living? Domestic or housework used to be frowned upon. Why? A domestic worker who has the talent in a busy household with 2 working parents who can do 3 homes a day will take home more money tax-free than the average manager working in a bank. You don't think of it that way, but that is the truth. Once you start to put perspective on what your value is and how you begin to put it to work, you understand that a government's role, as we see it, is to create space, opportunity, and structure to getting enterprise. And we believe that notwithstanding the government's expenditure of $400 billion, that we've not seen growth in our country. Let me come do a quick comparison before I invite Nicole to the microphone and then open the floor to the microphone for you all. Remember I told you the government said we were profligate? The PNM mathematics is as follows, as I welcome Terry Jadoonanan, candidate for Oro, which is for us. I'm surprisingly here Hi Terry, a happy belated birthday to you. So, PNM mathematics side by side. Don't hold too far. You have words to talk. PNM mathematics side by side to the UNCs. We spent in building Trinidad Generation Unlimited 26,000 homes, job creation, financial complexes, all of the things that we did. Highways, networks, water taxi, bus terminus, gate. We spent $267 billion in 8 years. This government just spent $400 billion in 5 years. When they said we were overheating the economy, the price of steel was 5 times the price it is today, because there was a big global demand for it. When we built 26,000 homes, they built 1,800 homes and they repaired 1,200. We built 26,000 homes for $5 billion. They built 3,000 homes for $7 billion. San Fernando is dying. There are very few places that we can go to that have nightlife, entertainment. You certainly can't walk along our beautiful waterways and feel safe with your loved one walking hand in hand, stop to buy an ice cream along the wharf. You should be able to do it. You will in the next 5 years be able to do it. But I can tell you, it's time for our fair share of it. But you can't do it in La Brea. And you can't do it in Urupuchis. So what's going on? It's okay if you spend more than you earn sometimes. Because if you spend more than you earn to establish a business, and then that business can generate revenue, and the revenue can pay back an amount to allow you to live and an amount to service your debt, and then in 5 years you're debt free and the rest is profit, great. But Trinidad and Tobago, if there's any human being in this room today who could raise their hand and name one single revenue generating investment that this government put into place, do so now. Just name one. Just one. That, ladies and gentlemen, is staggering. That you could have spent $400 billion and not have one single revenue generating asset in Trinidad and Tobago. So, our summary plan for us, the most important plan for us, is to deliver in the following areas: housing, jobs, crime and security, in ensuring that there's an efficient delivery through a transparent procurement process of government services, cutting your lots, eradicating mosquitoes, building things effectively, making sure youth are steered away from crime by having positive enforcement. Parks and recreation centers are a big thing for us. And a lot of our quality of life issues as citizens can be improved by our local government reform. If you think about Tobago and you ask yourselves, out of the following three people in Tobago, one, Minister for Tobago West, Delmon Baker, two, Minister for Tobago East, Vanilla Allen Toppin, three, Orville London, who is the most important person for Tobagonians? The answer is Orville London. Not because of any dislike for the first two, but because he is responsible for hiring and employing and bettering the lives of 65% of Tobago directly, and the other 35% indirectly. Tobagonians fix Tobago hospitals, Tobago buildings, Tobago roads, Tobago box streets. They cut Tobago grass, they fix Tobago highways. They make sure that Tobago security comes from Tobago. Imagine now, San Fernando, La Brea, Urupuch, Carney Central, where the city corporation has a mayor with an expanded set of services, with social workers, with community police, with contractors from the communities, where jobs are opened up now for you, for me, in law enforcement, in social work, in sports and entrepreneurship, in whatever field may be there. Imagine that now being capable under a mayor of San Fernando. That's where you begin to get away from what I call the VIP syndrome. You don't all, we don't all, because I won't always be in the position of being a member of parliament,
But we don't always need to know our MP. It isn't your MP who's supposed to fix your drain for you as your first port of call. It's your councillor who should have enough money to employ people from San Fernando West, to buy in a hardware in San Fernando West, to make sure that the work is done in San Fernando West, to get it done for San Fernando West. And that's the system that we're talking about. It means there's a young man in this audience, ladies and gentlemen, that has done so much for youth, and I want him to literally take a bow for the work of Carlton Lane. There he is, ladies and gentlemen. You have to see the football tournament that we have put on for young people in our central city, where there is nothing to do but watch rodents run by at times. There's a sense of desperation. A simple thing like recognizing in your long vacation, in what people now call the summer, we are no summer, but in your summer vacation, that you need to give youth the chance to burn a little energy, to have some fun, put a little music, give them a little prize, encourage them in something positive. When these young men turn up in their uniforms and they're looking sharp and they're out to battle, it's a beautiful thing to see. So 3 weeks to go in an election, the UNC has now decided they're running a basketball tournament in San Fernando West, top prize $100,000. I told my people, no problems, go and participate, take the money and ask them what take them so long.
Simple. When they come in again.
When they come in again, they come with 4 yellow jersey, take 10. Tell them you have people. Wash the inside corner of your tires with it, the brakes. While I was walking through a community, he asked me, he said, I have a present for you and I accept it. Now, UNC people like to hold you in long talk on your road, right? And I had to make sure to do it. So I'm talking to this fella, trying to figure out where he's coming from. Because in San Fernando, we can't judge a book by its cover. We are a community that is like none other in Trinidad and Tobago. All of us live together in a wonderful experience. So anyway, this fella stops on your road, and we're having a chat, and he says to me, after the long talk, and he take me through the ball, he says, I have a present to give you. I say, you'll take it? He says, you'll take it? I said, yeah, sure. Folds out a yellow UNC t-shirt he gave me one. I said, sir, please, you couldn't give me 3? And watch me. He say, you're serious? I say, boy, I have a real car to wash with. Man, watch me, he smile. He came back there, I say, you can't take back a baby, you're back at the boy. Because I was honest with him. I say, I will take the gift, I will wash my car. No problem, sir. But ladies and gentlemen, that's my not so short spiel to open up the conversations tonight. I want to invite Nicole and Terry to address us as well. And then I want you to have no holds barred and ask the questions that you want answered. Thank you so much for your attention.
To be here tonight with you all, good people of San Fernando West. Now, after Faris told him everything about all the pay and the policy, I really don't know what there's left for me to say.
Okay.
One thing I'd like to tell people knows is my story in becoming a politician. So this is the first time I've actually called myself a politician. So you can make sure I keep that piece of video clip. So it's the first time I've identified myself as a politician. Because I was really never interested in politics. Huh? All my life I felt that the country was being managed in a good enough fashion. It wasn't perfect, but I could have seen fairness and equity in the way the government was managing the country, in the way the government, well, I'm speaking of a PM government prior to 2010, of course, in the way the government would have appointed persons to look after our institutions and to look after our things. But really, since 2010 election, I have become more and more incensed and increasingly outraged at what I've been witnessing happening in the country. first one for me. I guess the first one might have been a wish me. When you take a telephone operator, a low-level employee, and put them in charge of the nation's security and intelligence service. That was the first one. And I said, what's going on? And what was the second? I mean, there are so many, it's hard to
pick
a chronology. But the really biggest one, one of them had a tipping point for me, was that state of emergency. I mean, us in the South, it really didn't affect us that much. I live in Santa Flora, which is just south of Tobago. There was no curfew in my area, so it didn't personally affect me. But I have friends that live in Port Spain. I have a sister that worked in Port Spain. I'm hearing the stories and seeing those images on TV, the way our fellow citizens are being treated. And I recognize how significantly that the elements would be impacted. When you look at, in fact, nightlife in Port Spain was effectively shut down for that period, which was 109 days of state of emergency. But there's absolutely no nightlife in Port Spain. So what would that have done to the economy of Port Spain? Meanwhile, things in the Safaria constituency went on like normal. The bars continued to function. The doubles vendors in there, they didn't have a problem. But all the coconut vendors around Pink's Rocks, around people in St. James. St. James is a city that never sleeps. What did they have to experience during that time? And I looked at the way these people were being treated. You see mothers and girlfriends on TV complaining, but they're going to remind them, they're trying to find their loved ones. Don't get no information. But where their husbands, their sons, or their brothers now. And what have they done? They just, because they live in an area that has been declared a hotspot, and this is by a government that came into power claiming they had a crime plan. They said they had a 100-day crime plan, they had a solution for crime. That was one of their biggest selling points. And then you have a state of emergency as a crime fighting measure. When you think about this, you look and you see people's rights being taken away from them. And you all know when the rights of any one person is taken away, all our rights are diminished. And that really was a tipping point for me. I saw this government really going down, leading the country in a direction that I knew I did not want to see the country anymore. But I didn't have just the one morning to say I wanted to go into politics. So first I started running. I asked my boss at work and I started suggesting to him, why don't you get involved in politics? You'll be a good member of parliament. But he's, because of his, well, he works as a consultant somewhere. He was certainly afraid to have his business impacted on declaring any kind of political affiliation. So one day he threw me back at me, so what about you since you're so passionate about it? Why don't you do that? Now, personally, my personality was not outgoing public speaking type person. So 3 years ago, I wouldn't be standing here talking to a room full of strangers. Yeah, I was quiet and shy. I still do have some evidence of that. But I feel as though over the last 4 years or so, my career path has led me in different stages of preparation for me to reach this stage. So I was exposed to various types of training that I think I'm actually preparing me well to serve as a representative. Well, I worked in the energy sector. Around 2010, I moved from the commercial area and I started working in the Office of Strategy Management and Risk Management. So I started doing lots of courses in change management, strategic planning, and all these things. And what I also did a lot of leadership development training, and I also had to start, when we were doing a strategic plan development, I had to start conducting workshops and these things. So all these different experiences really helped to develop my ability and brought me out a little bit so that I can now freely share with people and meet with people. I think so. I actually see my journey to becoming a candidate really as something that was preordained from as early as 2010. I've told a couple of people the story. Actually, first time I told the story would have been when I had my screening in PNM, well, private screening. Well, in 2010, I was actually in Ghana having negotiations with the Ghana Ministry of Energy discussing the option, the opportunity that Trinidad was there to invest in their pressure. One morning I was having a wonderful breakfast and a nice quiet time. And one of my colleagues came down and said, we spoke with his wife the night before, and she told him that Patrick Manning threatened to call her early election. And you know, just, and I immediately lost my appetite. You know, anyone who knows me knows I love to eat. I may not look that way, but I love my bed. So the fact that I lost my appetite, I was enjoying the breath, but the fact that I lost my appetite, it's because this sort of foreboding came over me. Just the knowledge, but because I was aware of the climate at that time in 2010, there was a lot of negative publicity about Patrick Manning. Everyone was saying, oh, Manning is too arrogant, that you were going on to call down. And just hearing that he's threatened to call it, and then said, like, what is going to happen to this country? Because I suspected that because of the negative climate, I knew what the results would be. And knowing from the experience of the UNC's previous term in office, I was just filled with this foreboding that country will be going through very, very hard times. And sadly, I mean, this is what has happened. Now, within the first month of the election, I was very depressed, yeah? I was saying, what has happened to us? So my sister was saying, come on, give them a chance. I said, girl, you don't know. But it took me a while to go through the full gamut of the emotions that you go through. You know, first it's this leap, and you know, and then you come to understanding, and you go through the stages, which are really depression, and then you come to a stage of acceptance. So I came to that stage of acceptance by the end of 2010. It was only until about 2013 I started seeing other people reach going through that cycle and reaching the stage of depression that I've gone through. But by this time, well, I was well accustomed to it, and I tell them, don't worry, we can fix this. And everything is in our own loss. We can't fix this. And that's part of the reason I really decided that I needed to get involved, because it became increasingly difficult to sit back and watch your country's culture was being wasted away. I worked in NGC. And to see NGC get involved in building a wastewater treatment plant, spending our cash behind a venture that really does not make much economic sense. And on top of that, spending $400 million more in a contract than is necessary. There's so many examples of abject wastage that has been done by this government. Then when you drive through areas and you see the neglect, and you see a need for expenditure, you see a need for services, I mean, it really touches your heart. It's like, how can people who claim to be Trinidadians treat any country in this manner? In 2010, when we lost the election, there were a number of schools in the process of being built in my constituency. 1 month after, so before the elections, there were like 200 Chinese guys living in this one house. I swear, 200 guys living in one house, they were working on the school. Within a month, you start seeing that, you know, that school has just been left abandoned. A lot of work was done. Most of the foundation was done, most of the walls and everything were up. Just a matter of putting the roof and finishing the school. That was just totally abandoned in 2010. Okay? But you see projects being conceptualized and built in areas where there's no need for it. But schools that, in areas where students need schools to be rebuilt. And why was this done? Just because their mission is to simply stop everything that PNM was doing? Do these people care about this country? I mean, if you have any affinity for this land, culture, and Trinidad and Tobago, would you treat it in this manner? I tell people that it's obvious they would not bring a property tax. Because if you're paying taxes, then you're paying to the government. And no, but the reason they stopped it because it would be as though they had given something to the country. And it's not in their hearts to give to the country. The country is something that they could take from. So they don't see the government and the country as something that belongs to them. So this is the underlying philosophy behind how they are operating. And I firmly believe that this government has no intentions of seriously going back in power. They don't expect to win. Nothing they have done has shown that they are seriously fighting an election, okay? They have this show called Canada 2015. But they're not trying to win the election. They are just, I believe they are simply hoarding away whatever money they can get to. Is it there for set as far as possible? So that every mountain you can get more money. Let's see how many more mountains you can take money from. Auditor, and at the end of the election period, you'll go somewhere else. That's what I feel you do. So I hope that all these lawyers in the PM know exactly why. Know exactly how to find them, to lock them up, because that is the only thing that will satisfy you. Okay? Now, I'm the terrorist lawyer, so are you going to tell us exactly how we're going to lock them up?
Good night, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Terry Jandana, representative for Urukuch East. Thank you all very much. After I called Faris from it was the first time anybody described Faris to me. Sorry
to interrupt. Just a quick house announcement. PCT 1959 and PDB 736. People are being blocked right now. They need to move urgently. If anybody upstairs here is a owner of those cars, we won't pretend we're seeing you walk out now. PCT 9059 and PDB 736. Your drink is by the bar downstairs.
It's gone? So, the first time I ever heard a story about Faris. Faris paints, Faris runs, Faris does karate, Faris does 500 other things that can't compete. Sorry? Faris speaks 5 languages. So I call him Superman. And after Superman speaks, there's nothing much we can really say about policy. After Nicole's story of why she entered politics is difficult to say why I came into politics. I'm just going to say what everybody's thinking right now. I am a very disgruntled citizen. I have been abroad. I left Trinidad last week, Thursday. And let me just acknowledge some people. Chelsea, Devin, Risa, and there's one specific person, Marion. There we go. Thank you very much. Lots of inspiration from you, and wrote a speech about David and Goliath that I was actually wanted to present on a platform last night at Faris's meeting on Coffee Street. But I was a bit ill and I could not have done it, so I will do it now, but I will do it for a night where maybe when Dr. Rowley comes to Urukuch East, then I will put a serious tongue lashing on. I'm not going to give him any acknowledgement, but on my opponent, Urukuch. I am very disgruntled simply because I'm on Facebook and it's camera. I'm on YouTube and it's camera. A couple moments ago, I was on my phone and Tevin messaged me, get off my phone. Lisa messaged me, get off my phone. Chelsea messaged me, I'm trying to take pictures of you, get off your phone. But I just got a text from camera 2015. And it says, hi Terry, please take a look at my plan for the next 5 years with 20 clear commitments for 2020. BIT, Kamala, 20 for 2020. Let me just say that 2020 thing was a PNM vision. They took it into 2020. So they are now campaigning on the PNM's watchword, Vision 2020. Faris said, when he initially started, they ran a budget of $400 billion. I don't know if anybody read the newspaper yesterday. No, I don't buy physical copies of the newspaper. I'm sorry to the experts. They just go get my money. I read it online. So pay the internet, read it online. And I read SIS got $237 billion. How in God's name could one company, one contractor, hang on, let this go along. How could one contractor get half Well, correct. More than half of the allocated budget of 5 years. That is ridiculous. If you all don't understand that, you all are crazy. And according to my political leader, the majority of Trinidadians and Tobagonians are writing in citizens. And if anyone read what I read, we know where to put the X. Putting the X on the back. One contractor in the history of Trinidad and Tobago, in fact, in the Western Hemisphere, has ever gotten half of the allocated, or more than half of the allocated budget for one term of government. That is out of the way. And it happened in Trinidad and Tobago. And this is something that, you know, these are things that people may just read and bypass. But look at the figures. One individual, $237 billion. I am petitioning for 6 years to have a pavement made from Block 5 in Palmies to Palmies Park. I don't know if you all are familiar with Palmies Park. I live in Palmies. I'm born and grew up there. I live in Block 5. And I see all, I grew up there, so I know. I played when there were 5 houses in Block 5. And, sorry. And now Palmies is overpopulated. Palmies Park is overused and really needs to be developed more. And I'm seeing little kids and elders walking on the road and these young guys who are racing, you know, they just have no consideration at all for anyone. And I had in mind to issue for these race guys and them a racetrack in Orguchis. But it was a policy, well not a policy, it was a plan that I had in mind. And would have directed to the necessary agencies or the necessary ministries, because Orukuchis has a vast majority of communities left. And these guys in South, we all know they all like to spend their money on South Tex and people in Port are spending by Porsche and people in Labrie by Benz.
He sells everything.
He sells everything. Sorry. I shop at school, sorry. There's not much to say about that. So I had a plan to have a racetrack or race being developed in Old Beach. And that is something that, I mean, if you all think about it, could generate a lot of commercial activities in Old Beach. Alright? Correct. And you pay, you have to be properly licensed, you have to be properly certified to race on these tracks. They close down all the field and have these guys racing on the road. They're racing golf under. I was coming home a couple of days ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, and there was a head-on collision. Two guys racing, and they're racing and cross-crossing. You all know these things. You all know these things. They race from the half a mile track from one from traffic light to the next. And, I mean, that really needs to stop. That falls in Faris' constituency. And I'm looking at developing Orukuch in a way that nobody has ever taught us it could have been used. And not only put congestion into border Spain, but take it out of border Spain and put it into Orukuch. Orukuch borders San Fernando West and San Fernando East. All the commercial activities take place in San Fernando West. There's no space in San Fernando West. Paris is trying to get rid of traffic, trying to get rid of all these congestions. But literally five minutes away, there's Paris. 5 minutes away from that is where they're building this multi-billion dollar highway that is broken down now. Because I drove past and everything is just broken. If you all follow the news again, OAS is another, that's another factor for you all not to support this one. So I'm just disgruntled, that's what it is. It's hard to discuss. I mean, there's not much you can really say because all my anger is directed towards my opponent, who is not there. And he has been screened 2 weeks ago. There's literally 24 days to election. I have been walking my constituency since the 2nd of January. I have not. There's no motorcade. There's no big hurrah. There's not 500 people walking behind me. There's just me five guys meeting, knocking on everybody's door, walking on every single road. I've walked on roads that they repaved recently. And today I walked in Union Hall and I met a couple guys and I said, wow, congratulations, you all finally got your road paved. When I walked in February, there was just potholes everywhere. And I told them, I said, well, you all need to look at this now and don't take it as they did you a favor. Because roads, lights, water, you all are entitled to that. Alright? That is something that you are voting for. That is something you are paying taxes for. That is something when you get your paycheck and you take your $5,000, you look at it and you take $2,000 in your life. All that money goes to the government. So that means you don't put us. You know? Your light is yours, water is yours, telephone is yours. You know, anything that attached to Trinidad and Tobago Electricity Company, Trinidad and Tobago Telecommunication, that is all government run. You know, it's not private. You know, there are some private stakes in it, but I don't know. Thank you all again. I appreciate being here. I'm very disappointed. I mean, you all share that with you as well. The floor is open to Faris because he answers everything.
No. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to say thank you to my colleagues. Sarah will be here soon, so we will have another one. But you've heard some of the perspectives, just to sew it up in a nutshell. Clearly, we have a view as to why we want to be, on this occasion, representatives of the political party which we support. People in this room, we come from a very diverse background, all of us. I know where all of you come from, because I've met you at home, most of you. The truth is this, that's why I said most, I saw a few heads there, right? I'm quick, you know. Right? But the truth is this, if we haven't met you physically, very few of you not physically, we met you online, right? Everybody. The fact is, it's good enough to speak to the choir, to preach to the choir. What we want is the opportunity to address your concerns. Now for the political talk. Let's hear now from you. What is it that you want to address? Specifics, facts, aspirations, lines of sight, as we put it out a little bit earlier. Microphone is on this end, this table here. Just wave your hand and pass across the microphone to you, and all of us will do our best to deliver. I happen to have had a little bit more time in the PNM for the last 5 years, so I will field most of them, but wherever I can pass the microphone, it's a joint enterprise. The one thing that we have going for us in the PNM is that we are well organized and that we're on a system of development. Our policy will be produced in fine detail in just a matter of a week or so, and you will be able to analyze it for yourself. We ask that you carry this message forward, whether you think we've satisfied questions well, whether you think there's room for improvement. We'd like to hear from you as to your feedback, because this is something that we intend to do for the next 5 years. If it's one thing we do, we're going to break this mold where people say we see politicians once every 5 years. We are going to break that mold. So microphone is open now. We have the lovely Marianne with it there. John's hand pops up first.
Good night, everybody. My question is for Mr. Al-Rawi. We hear a lot of people talking that they're going to be doing local government. I would like to know what level of autonomy is local government going to experience with regards to generating revenue and delivering services that become inclusive.
Fantastic. The question ties into how do you earn your money? And how do you control the money that you have? That's the way I take the question, because autonomy is, of course, your degree of control. In our redeveloped local government structure, we envisage, we have councillors that are elected by the people, aldermen that are appointed, and then we have an executive management structure. Much like Tobago has the secretary for finance and the secretary for whatever else it may be.
We then have an entire population on an organizational chart of people that comprise the system. In this system, it is envisaged that the corporation will receive two forms of revenue. The first is from central government, where the central government takes its physical money and gives every regional corporation money. And then the second one is where your property taxes and other assets which generate revenue go to you. Let's explain that. The fact is, they say that the only thing that is certain in life is death. Well, there's another saying, the only thing that is certain in life is death and taxes. We pay taxes as a matter of fact. And there ought to be nothing wrong with paying taxes. But Trinidad and Tobago has been invited to consider taxation as a dirty word. Corruption is not a dirty word. It's now sanitized and it's called itafu. Right? Oh, Sarah eat a food. Well, you know, Sarah eat a food. Man, very big sweat. Oh, Sarah eat a food. Because we have now taken eat a food to a level of gluttony. It is the label that is put upon everything which says, turn your eye to corruption. But taxation, if it's properly done, you don't mind paying. If you can see your tax-paying dollars at work for you, in your society, you're prepared to pay more. And I'll tell you where it's done. You travel outside of Trinidad and Tobago, go to North America, for example, and you see different communities have different levels of taxation. Some people move away from it, some people move to it, and are prepared to pay more because they get better services from the city. For those of you who don't know, you remember something called Axe the Tax?
Yep.
They had a much slimmer looking fellow, Prakash Ramada, back in 2010. He's a good friend of mine. I won't speak him badly. I've known him for many years. But he championed the COP's livelihood on something called Axe the Tax. Up and down Trinidad and Tobago, nimble and fit. And the other day, Prakash Ramada asked Dr. Rowley, bold-facedly, tell Trinidad and Tobago what you're going to do about the property tax now. Dr. Rowley watched me and said, Faris, what our manager say? I said, well, Doc, you asked him about property tax? He said, no. Property tax? Because Dr. Rowley believes that people actually know what they're saying. Prakash Ramada did not know that the UNC government implemented the property tax and divided it into three phases. Phase one, agricultural, which is in effect and you've been paying it for 2 years now. Phase two, industrial and commercial, which is in effect and you've been paying it for a year now. And phase three, which comes in September 2015. The man did not know that his own government had implemented the same acts he was looking to tax that he was looking to ask. And he is a senior member of the cabinet. And what Dr. Rowley said was, our statement on property tax is the same as yours. You ought to pay your fair share, but we will review the taxation. Because it has to be that people pay taxes which are within their means. It can't be ridiculous. And the problem with taxation was that they were using a value on properties which was exorbitant. They were using a rental value for properties that didn't make sense. If you said to them, well, rent it for that now, and I'm going to move out and take the rent. That was what the average Trinidadian said. So we need to review that to ensure that taxation levels fall, because San Fernando West currently pays the highest level of taxation in the whole of Trinidad and Tobago. And what we intend to do, John, is to take the property taxes, put that into the regional corporation, take the national, same way Tobago gets a certain fixed percentage, put that into the pot, and then if you have assets owned by the state, like Skinner's Park, like the Southern Academy for the Performing Arts, like other waterfront development that we will put down, where there's a charge concession basis, like the market when it is redeveloped as we will redevelop it. When you start generating revenue from those assets, it's used by the city for the city. traffic offenses. We collect millions of dollars every year for parking offenses, for tickets, for speeding. Those will come also after review to a local government structure as it's done elsewhere. So the plan is to use your revenue in your city and to allow people the opportunity to see their own dollars at work for themselves so that they can choose if this is where they want to live or not. Anyone else? Gentlemen at the back.
My question is for anyone to answer. I want to know what would be done for young entrepreneurship. I'm a business owner, a young business owner, and one of my challenges is facing funding, getting or being awarded a contract. Well, that was due to a lot of corruption based on the tender process. Also, I am an entrepreneur in the creative sector. I do own a recording studio. I do own a sound system, and I do soundproofing and acoustics. It is heavily in the creative sector. What would be done to boost or bolster the creative sector? And lastly, I am a legitimately US need business. This morning I went to the bank and I needed 3,000 US, which is stuck, and I was told that
complete shutdown
of all currency.
Yep.
And I would like to know on those three fronts what would be done, because it's not just me alone.
Sure. Excellent. Yeah. Let's start with the last point. Ladies and gentlemen, in case you didn't know, as of today, the entire foreign exchange market in Trinidad and Tobago has crashed. Crashed for the first time in the history of Trinidad since we floated our foreign exchange rate. It has crashed. And that is what you get when you appoint people that don't have a clue how to run the systems that they're put in charge of. Rashmi on steroids. That's what that is. So, we're waiting to see what explanation they will fabricate for this, because I want to let you know something. September 17th on Monday is nomination day. August 17th on Monday is nomination day. I was just about to look to Terry to say I don't count it in days, but I count it in Sundays. Because after this Sunday, there are three more Sundays to go, including the eve of elections, right? That's like Christmas Eve for me. Now, what you must expect to see is that after the close of nominations on the 17th of August, expect all hell to break loose by the UMC. What do I mean by that? For those of you old enough to remember, or those of you who may have researched the position, there has never been in the history of post-Republican elections, that's post-1976, there's never been, certainly at least from 1981 onward, a time when a government called an election and did not have candidates on the field already. Never. San Fernando West is a seat that has to be won by whomever will comprise the government. So this government is going to, quote unquote, attempt to win this seat in 3 weeks. That means you can expect them to lie, cheat, buy, beg. And that fits in to the question you asked. Foreign exchange, I just expect them to say anything. They don't care whether it's a lie or not. And I'm sorry to be so pejorative, but it is the fact. I've watched Dr. Munilal stand up and lie bold-facedly. He said Dr. Rawley is the first leader on opposition to get security by the government. When it was the opposite, he was the first leader of the opposition to lose security. Kamla had it, Basu Pandey had it, Manning had it before him. Everybody had it for all their time as leader of the opposition. It's only when Kamla became the prime minister and Dr. Rawley became
the leader of the opposition, that she took away his security and Gary Griffith put it back in when he came in. Entrepreneurship, incentivization for sectoral growth, one of which is in the industry that is on the agenda of every government. Every government speaks to cultural incentivization and it as a business. It is important to bear in mind that we have finite resources. Everybody knows that. We know that we're an oil and gas economy. We know it's going to run out. We know we have about 30 years of proven reserves with the new statistical data on the inside. But the fact is, unless we hurry up and diversify as we had planned and started in 2010, by 2010 under a PLN government, we had significant anchors for diversification, be it in aluminum. You didn't have to smelt it. You could use the electricity using natural gas, smelt it cheap and have an aluminum industry. You could have had a financial services sector. You could have had telemarketing. You could have had all of these basin of services. Dubai is oil and gas. Almost 65% of its revenue comes from non-oil and gas revenue generation, particularly in financial services sector. So we weren't reinventing the wheel. Insurance comprises 27% of our contribution to GDP in Trinidad and Tobago. People don't realize that. The insurance industry alone, 27% of our GDP. So we are very committed to diversification away from oil and gas. And one of the easy, low-hanging fruit is in fact in the cultural entertainment. Jamaica has done wonders with it, and so can we, but we need to make it quote-unquote sexy. Same thing we need to do with agriculture. There's a gentleman I know who plants Cardo tomatoes out of one lot of land that he owns and takes home $20,000 guaranteed a month from a lot of land that is lying vacant. Imagine if that was a lot of land next to you that had grass 12 feet high and the neighbor doing nothing about it. And you had a guaranteed $20,000 a month to go home with. I bet you, you're going to cut the grass and plant the tomato tomorrow. But it can be done. And your regional cooperation reform will allow you to do that. Because if there are vacant lots that are not being tended to, the corporation has the power to enter, cut, clean, put it to productive use. Get it done right, tell the owner. Either you do something with it or we will. Of course, you must follow the law scrupulously and you can't take away people's property rights. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that there are lots of green spaces that the state owns that can be put to good use. And while they laughed at our move into mega farms are what reduce the price of food. So when you buy a Nutramix chicken in Massey stores, as it's now called, the day before when it arrived at the store and it spent one night only in a refrigerator, it was 35% cheaper than they selling it for. 35%. Same thing with vegetables. Should you be obliged to pay people? A lot of people say, can you bring back a rent restriction board to control rents? People are paying $2,700, $2,100 for single room places. I mean, ladies, I've seen their homes. Gentlemen, I've seen their homes. Rats, cockroaches, boards making noise upstairs, water leaking. At $2,700 a month in rent, or $2,100 a month in rent, you could be paying a mortgage for an HDC home twice over. And we commit to that kind of housing to give you that opportunity on a proper needs basis. But it's the same thing creating the competition in farmers markets, in agricultural large-scale development, where you can get the product off the field and onto your home plates faster, that drives prices down. So you don't need a board to control expenditure, you just need to improve competition. But on the entrepreneurship side, San Fernando is guaranteed a waterfront project. Waterfront requires entertainment, restaurants, people to work in it, chefs. You all remember a long time ago, some of you are too young to know this, when somebody called you a cook
What do you do? I'm a cook. It used to be something that you weren't so proud of. Today, if you're a chef or a sous chef, it's a damn good profession to have. It's become a noble profession. It earns handsomely well. People are prepared to pay. When I was growing up, we all drank water from the pipe. Nobody could have dreamed that a human being would possibly consider buying a bottle of water. Why would you do that? Think about it. Who would pay $20 for a cup of coffee? Why would you do that? Well, the point is people now have choice. And there is nothing wrong with that if the money circulates. If you give somebody the opportunity to have a cafe, to have a retreat, to enjoy a place to sit with quiet measure. And that's what we hope to encourage, so that we are pouring some resources into the entrepreneurial sectors that require them. But we need to create structures for it. Some of it is physical outlay structures, which in San Fernando will mean certainly a waterfront and redevelopment of parking areas and transportation areas. You're guaranteed for that. Is there anyone else?
I have a question. San Fernando West. However, it requires an injection of money. To that end, my question pertains to the economy. Where's the money going to come from, especially in light of the potential for crude prices to drop to $30 per barrel? And at that price, are we going to be able to sustain an economy?
Sure.
What are the intentions to navigate this lower oil price and to ensure the longevity of the economy? And that, given the backdrop that for the past 5 years we have done deficit budgeting, how are we going to come out of that with a balanced budget?
Excellent, excellent question. How are you going to afford it? Trinidad and Tobago has survived on $7 a barrel of oil. When we didn't have oil, we built a railway, we built highways, we built buildings, we built hospitals. We survived on sugarcane in those days. Not having money or having to borrow money to do certain projects is not an uncommon thing. Our difficulty is not going to be the price of oil, really. It's going to be our renegotiation of the gas prices in Atlantic LNG in particular. So what we don't appreciate, because the government is hiding it, and it's interesting because in Dubai, they just fired 25% of their workforce. And Qatar did the same thing. Just this week, Bloomberg announced it. So the prices of oil are going to go down. But in Trinidad and Tobago, whereas we may earn 50 cents on a gas dollar, because when we were first on the block, we used to be number four in the world in gas production. And we had entered the market early because Patrick Manning made a damn good decision to get there with Ken Julian and others. And we were once supplying 75% of the Eastern Seaboard United States gas needs. So when we were first on the block, we were able to secure sweetheart deals where we told the men, come here, but we had to get a good stake. You drill, we'll give you this, you pay us royalties, but we want 50 cents on the dollar. Fast forward now to 2015, everybody's into gas. There's been fracking and shale gas revolution. And Qatar is open, Africa is open. Stick a pin for a minute. Why Nicole went into a big depression? In 2010, a PNM government took NGC to Africa. And our two closest allies in the world was Venezuela and South Africa. And we had just chummied up to Ghana. Big time. Why? They were the emerging markets, and Venezuela, we share the largest field between us, the Loran Manatee field. And there was some foresight in saying we need to go there. And then there was a small company back then who was now at the cusp of an unknown technology called fracking,
a small company who came to Trinidad and said, we want to be partners with you. And we signed a deal with them to be partners with them, and we agreed to start a waterfront project in Port of Spain. And in that high-rise tower, we were going to put in a commodities trading division. And what we were going to do is to take NGC, having stakeholding in NGC Trinidad, NGC Ghana, Uganda, South Africa, and anywhere else in the world, like small companies once did, who then grew into giants called BP and BG, British Petroleum and British Gas, started in Britain, but then expanded. Do you know that 25% of BP's revenue is earned on one oil well in Trinidad and Tobago? Did you know that? 25%. And this small company that we had signed this deal for was a company called Cheniere. And they are today the largest supplier and producer of shale gas in North America. And the man who had the distinction of screwing that deal is a fellow named Kevin Ramirez, who might be my opponent in San Fernando West. Right? But I'm telling you the gospel truth. Fast forward back into the question now. In 2016, we are going to renegotiate our gas prices. And now the companies tell us, well, give us incentive to stay, because we will just go to Africa. So we're no longer going to earn 50 cents on every dollar. We may go down to 10 or 15 cents on every dollar. It's as bad as that. But fear not. We are confident that we know what to invest in. And we have mapped out strategically where our oil and gas sector needs to go. Our international partners have invited Dr. Rowley and his team members to see them at home in their home bases. And fingers crossed, they're waiting to see the writing on the wall come to reality. We intend to invest in projects that create revenue generation, and we will borrow to do projects that have to be done. Because unless you spend the money to do it, you will not get the diversification and we will collapse. We can survive on culture. What does Disney World do? What do they produce? They produce entertainment. They move 1 million people a day through their parks. 1 million people a day. They're merchandising. Their creation. We have that talent. We are a natural safe harbor. We can produce carnival villages. We can produce a yachting industry. We have South America, which we could see on a clear morning. We can import lumber. We can do ship repair. We are not with the difficulties that Venezuela or Guyana has, so or Suriname, which means that vessels can come out of Panama and park in Trinidad and get supplies. And yet, that means chefs earn money. That means shipbuilders, carpenters, painters, cleaners, welders. The potential is enormous. So we will have to invest in those areas of culture and entertainment, and also in terms of harboring and yachting as well. And we'll have to spend the money to get there. So we very much have in mind, how do we earn a dollar? As I welcome Junior Regrello, Deputy Mayor, and my very best supporter in San Fernando West. So I hope I've done some justice to your question here. Deficit financing was your last aspect. Deficit financing is not a bad thing. It's typical Keynesian philosophy. You ought not to be afraid of deficit financing, provided that you're investing in revenue generation. So what we have to do now, when we get into office, is to analyze what our true debt to GDP ratio is. You know what my fear is? My fear is not the election only. We, the PNM, have a budget to deliver before October 31st. And we don't know what the true state of the economy in Trinidad and Tobago is, and what the debt to GDP ratio is. Because there are so many offshoots. By the way, Terry mentioned to you, SIS had $237 billion in contracts. I want to put that in the context of
the PNM spent $267 billion in 8 years. So SIS earned 89% of what the PNM spent to do everything that we did in 8 years. So it's a serious conversation, but I want to let you know something. There are so many people in Trinidad and Tobago, a couple of whom I've met, tell me that they are undecided. People are undecided. And there are people who will go to the voting booth and just vote UNC, whether they bring a candidate currently labeled as Casper, the friendly ghost in San Fernando West. When Casper materializes into human form on Sunday and turns up on Monday, 89% of the UNC people will just turn up and vote for Casper. Only 65% of PNM people actually come out when they push. So we have a margin, and that 65% is enough to beat the UNC anywhere. But my point is, there's still a 25% of known, named PNM people who can still come out to vote. And we need, on this occasion, because ladies and gentlemen, I, like Terry, like Nicole, have given up my own personal pursuits, my 3 children, my career, my business enterprises, and your privacy to serve for 5 years. Because believe me, service requires full-time effort. And if I had a dollar for everybody who needs a house and who tells you of their plight, you would realize how wealthy you could be just off of that $1. People are burning. 4,500 of San Fernandians live in abject poverty. You have to see it. That's the obvious poverty. We have a whole set of us that live in hidden poverty. And that is another very serious problem. And the reason why it takes all hands on deck is to try and solve that. Because it is everybody lending a bit of assistance. Our obligation is to be transparent and to communicate, to give you this line of sight so that we can understand where we are. Because it isn't good enough to say, well, boy, I didn't have the money to do it. You want to be able to, and our vision collectively involves us coming to our constituents and saying, we have 12 plans, here's the priority in the plans. We're sharing this with you. So that people can understand why you spent in the way that you spent. Okay, anyone else?
Hi, good night.
Hello.
My question deals with housing. As somebody who is renting right now, I want to know how are you going to make housing affordable for me? And because we all know this lottery system, I don't know what is your requirement to get put for, right? I mean, that's just a little joke, right?
Oh, yeah.
And also for the land as well. What, how are you going to, you know, make it accessible for us? I shouldn't say me alone, for us.
Well, for all of Trinidad.
Yes, for all of Trinidad, definitely needs a house. And, you know, these high rents you're paying, it's sometimes very exorbitant. You don't know what you have to do to hustle to pay that rent. So I would like to know how best they will deal with that situation.
Excellent question. That's a multi-pronged attack. One. Land becomes expensive, rents go high when there's heavy demand. When there's less demand, things fall. So you pay a high rental in San Fernando because everybody wants to be there to be closer to school or closer to work, etc., or wherever else it may be. Imagine now having the ability to live a little bit further out but get to work in less time. Because you could jump on something called mass transportation, be it railway, be it bus, without traffic. I work in Port of Spain. I have to come down to San Fernando, 3 hours of traffic every day, do my regular work in San Fernando, and then back again. I'm very happy to do that, by the way. It's part of what the job requires, right? So, when people laugh in the UNC about the PNM Rapid Rail, tell them, come and walk in our shoes.
Exactly.
Because it affects housing. In our vision of mass transportation,
housing in what the Americans call, fancy word for it, suburbia. Suburbia is a lovely place to live. Anywhere else in the world, you want to live in the suburbs. It's very nice to live in the suburbs. In Trinidad, it's called the country. And you're living there. Yeah, you're living in the bush. You're living behind going back. Well, we want to make our suburbs, we want to make our bush the suburbs. So transportation is one of the key factors. The second thing is, the government can't do everything. It is ridiculous for us to assume that if the wind blow and your roof fall off, the government had to fix it. You fall on your bomb city, the government had to fix that. What the government do for me, they never do nothing for me because we've created a dependency syndrome. So what we need to do is to get people back up to the, you know, you never hear the United States people in all of their movies. You notice that they have this simple thing, everybody wants to achieve a dream. You ever hear politicians in the United States talk? Barack Obama's speeches amaze me. His simple one-liners. We have to fight. Yes, we can. We can be better. You know, he had this long spiel about what you're going to do and how you're going to translate and you paint the picture and you connect all the dots. We have to roll up our sleeves and get to work. Time to be honest. That's what people talk about. Simple motivational things about hard work, about honesty, about having a pride in a job. It's the thing that I said about domestic work earlier. I tell you tomorrow morning, if I'm not a lawyer, I will go and make cleaning houses the best industry possible and make real money doing it. Terry Jadoonanan, ladies and gentlemen. Right? This man is an encyclopedia on how to do it. And he has the most phenomenal story on how he became a seriously successful businessman. In 5 years, after qualifying as a lawyer, father as a policeman, borrowing money that his father could never imagine he could have paid back, and paying it back in 6 months.
9 months.
But he is a living example which we intend to take over and over in Trinidad and Tobago about entrepreneurship, because there's nothing wrong with the BSc, the behind the store counter degree. That's what we're talking about. It's about making sure that you have the desire to work. So, suburbia, mass transportation, public-private partnership, because the government can't do everything with you. When state does some development and private individuals do the other, we can facilitate, for instance, the acquisition of land by making people permanent employees as opposed to contract workers. So they can afford to get a loan in the bank because they're not working month to month. That's what we're talking about. So that's why I said multi-pronged. We now on the third limb there, which is permanence of employment. The last aspect now is in encouraging people to be entrepreneurs themselves and to build. Competition makes it more affordable. So it's a multi-pronged approach, and then there's traditional government-sponsored housing, which has to be done by proper needs assessment. People can't be meeting in the road and saying, I applied in 1971 for a house and I ain't get it yet. There's a man who I know lives in a particular community, 12 of them sleeping in a room the size of this area here. 12 people. He is disabled. There are people living on the wharf in San Fernando 60 years without water and lights because they're temporary. I didn't know 60 years was temporary. At least have the dignity to give them something in the interim. And by the way, the reason why we didn't do it in the last 5 years is that we had allocated a home for every single one of them because we started the waterfront development and they shut it down. All they did was build one long galvanized fence and the grass about 30 feet high on top of the piles that we laid down there, which have all sunk into the sea. So, that's how we'll address housing. Next question.
That question, it is a spin on what the lady asked just now. One of the essentials to PNM government moving forward is housing. I am asking, why there is the HDC initiative could there be a plan for people who are in a certain income bracket, not in getting an agency house, but in acquiring land as landowners and building their own house? Because those who have an income bracket of, let's say, $25,000 a month, $30,000 a month, obviously would be in a better position to do more than somebody who is, let's say, $10,000 a month. I fall into, I'm also entrepreneurial, right? Family business, to be, you know, exact. And with a family business, the dynamic is a little different. So you have much of the revenue from the business going back into the business, right? And so for someone like me whose income, even though the business may generate so much, you are still governed by a certain salary. And I too, you know, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I have two small children. Not everyone will be fortunate to probably acquire an HDC house. Is there something that can be put into some type of movement for land ownership? I don't know if it can be in the form of an incentive, so that, you know, people like me and others could acquire that type of housing.
Yes, the answer is yes. Thank you. Just to let you know, I served at the HDC in the period where we built 26,000 homes. And we specifically invested in housing which was not only low income, it was mid, and in some cases upper mid to upper. And we did it at subsidized rates as well, because we realized that there were a number of people now working, what I call the enslaved working population, where the tie for gentlemen means that you're a mark of slavery, right? I tell people all the time, my liberation in life is to take off a tie, right? Or to wear a short pants, right? So yes, we intend to do this multi-pronged housing approach, but there is going to be the public-private arrangement, certain areas that the state will do infrastructure on, and then ensure that the lots are available to people for construction in a schematic way. That's one of the ways it's done in Turkey, it's done in Europe, where there are cooperative arrangements that are done. Our Royston project was a very good example. Royston 1 through 6 was phenomenal examples of first-class housing put down that did very, very well. So we have the experience in doing it. Listen, if you have one man in this room I want to win the election more than anybody else, it's Terry. Because his opponent is Rudan Rila. You see? And the other day I tell Munilal, I say, if you need a man, come and run in San Fernando West. Don't hide in Rotary. I say, if you need a man, come and run. You and Mrs. Pasad, Mrs. Sessa, both of all you, give up your safe seat and come and run in San Fernando West. And let's see how genuinely appreciated you are amongst people that are prepared to think. Because we have some non-traditional voters, eh? And that is important. We are here in this conversation to persuade you. I don't want you to vote because my grandmother is PNM, and if I don't vote PNM, they're going to beat me, like some of our parents say. The point is, you must be able to genuinely say, you know what, I'm voting for a PNM because I can associate with them.
You do have an opponent.
I have an opponent?
Yes.
Who?
Joel.
Oh. I think Joel has more guts than that. What I will say is that I wish her well, and I think that she's a courageous person, and I have nothing negative to say about her or anybody else. Let me just say this. She has had the courage to do things that other people have not had the courage to do in life, and I make no judgment or cast any point of view on anyone. I wouldn't say that she's more man than Mila as the simple point is that you have to do a mixed arrangement, because I'll tell you this, your eyes as a father are now fixed on your children. You become secondary. What occupies your attention right now is, how do I provide for them 30 years from now? How will they afford a home?
how will they afford a life? So we are in the same zone, but in our experience at HDC, we took a lot of time to make sure that the Land Settlement Agency worked right, and that the Housing Development Corporation worked right, including greenfield development for sites where the private sector could step in, do the construction yourself, at your own pace, with your own mortgage, on land that is subsidized by mortgages at subsidized rates. So it doesn't have to be that the land itself is cheap, you know. But if you get a 2% mortgage to do what you want to do, that's the gift. So that's where it can work. Because let me put it to you this way. Making money is not a bad thing. I don't know why people have this obsession in saying politicians shouldn't earn a decent standard of living. To me, the problem is if you're telling a man to come and do a job, knowing that you're underpaying him grossly and he's happy to do it, you gotta ask yourself, why? Either altruism or he's just a plain thief. One of the two. Or as some people used to put it in the old days, crooks almost. So we have to rise out of that particular, you know, stigma. So there's nothing wrong with people making money, private entrepreneurs making money. But when the PNM was overheating the economy, was it such a bad thing? Because government was now in competition with private sector, but everybody was making money. It wasn't 89% of your revenue going to SIS. Exactly. Next question.
Yes, hello, good evening. What I would like to find out is on the Ministry of Education. We say that we're investing.
I feel terrible that I'm answering all of these questions.
And I'm directing it to anyone.
It's only because my colleagues have not had the benefit of seeing some of the policy that I have seen because of what I do in the party right now. Okay, so please accept that they are equally able, but just not yet officially clothed with that knowledge just yet, okay?
No problem. Within the Ministry of Education, there's the support services for students who are supposedly dyslexic, ADHD, ADD. I have had experience dealing with the support services, and they are understaffed, and they are not doing what they're supposed to be doing. They're helping students who are in wheelchairs, who cannot go to the washrooms for themselves, and children who really need the support and need the services are being left behind. Therefore, we have so many other children passing through the system, not being able to read, not being able to do, you know, well in school, and we are wondering why. And then we're seeing crime level is rising. Children are behaving bad in school. What is the policy, or what would be the implementations with this government, where the Ministry of Education is concerned, the hiring of the proper persons to bring forth a better education system for Trinidad and Tobago? Because too many years we have heard and we have seen money put into the education system and it has not gone anywhere.
Fantastic. We are best with statistics globally and in Trinidad now, seriously. Why? Under this government, it can be manipulated. So we have had, for the first time ever, the Central Statistics Office of Trinidad and Tobago shut down. I did 4 budgets in the last 5 years where the statistical information for the budgets were done by the Ministry of Finance and not by the Central Statistics Office. So who believes that they have a 3% unemployment rate in Trinidad? Put up your hand. Who believes that crime is at an all-time low in Trinidad and Tobago? Put up your hand. Who believes that retrenchment is at an all-time low? Put up your hand. Right? I mean, you are clips all that. So, the truth is, that statistical obsession has now gone into the SEA. And then we now pass everybody. 18,000 students now reach into secondary school. We get to secondary school. We have people that pass through GATE as certified, qualified professionals in the very fields you're asking about, who are not employed by the state. I met a girl on a flight.
working for the airline, Trinidadian girl. 3 university degrees. Social care, psychology, fair. Out at the University of the West Indies, woman can't get a job in the Ministry of Education. We just saw a woman commit suicide after she left an abusive relationship. Her child killed accidentally the man that was about to shoot his wife. You know what I'm talking about? You know, sometimes I wonder about the poor Brigadier Minister of National Security. But where were social services then? It's an automatic thing that should be happening. And that applies into the schools. And what we are talking about in our manpower audit, because that's another big thing for us. We intend to do manpower audits of entities. The police requires a manpower audit. We need to know how many people are required to do the job. For instance, San Fernando City Corporation has 24 municipal police to service 250,000 people. 24 people to make you sleep well at night. The manpower audit obviously says that's inefficient. Therefore, we can hire more people, jobs for people. In the school sector, for dyslexia, for attention deficit syndrome, for whatever it may be, that is an absolute requirement as well. We have another problem. Our school curriculum is not assisting our young males. And when you go, well, it's worse for the males. Because I'll challenge you to this. Go to any university or tertiary level program now and count the number of men in the class. I look at the call to the bar every year. Of 100 people called to the bar, 92 to 97 of them are women. Medicine is climbing. It used to be heavy male dominated. It still is fairly, but its statistics have come up. Engineering. Men are more and more falling out of the working environment. And where are they going? Because they can't open businesses to survive. They're hustling. And if I tell you that the number one issue for young men that I have met in my own constituency, as Terry would know, as Nicole would know, is employment. And they don't want to be no bad boy, you know. They want to feed their family. They want to be respected as earning a dollar legitimately. So we have in our school system to also address the orientation for males as well. But it starts with our manpower auditing and making sure that the right people are hired, because the talent is there. That's what GATE was designed to do. It was designed to produce people with academic qualifications that could then be absorbed into the systems where they were needed. And we just, you know, guys, the simple thing is this, we lost 5 going on 6 years with this government. They were given a chance, but we lost the opportunity. But you know what? We get the government we deserve. The PNM lost the election fair and square. It spent a lot of time reforming itself, engineering its policies, choosing its people. Dr. Rowley is not an egocentric man. He don't like compliments. People say he's angry. I said this last night. He's angry. And then I saw the gentleman who won the Nobel Prize together with Malala Yousafzai, Kailash Satyarthi, I think that's his name, who is a champion against child labor in India. And he was doing an interview with Faris Zakaria on CNN 2 weeks ago. And Faris' first question to him was, they say you're an angry man. And he said, in the face of injustice, wouldn't you be angry too? And that's how I'm now going to say, anybody who tell me Dr. Rowley angry, I'm going to tell him, well, what, wouldn't you be angry about Section 34? Or Reshmi? Or SIS contracts? Or life sport? Or, I mean, the prison gate, email gate? Whatever you want to call it, the bacchanals, I'm numbed. I have been a lawyer, 90% of them, and I can't remember all of them. Dana Sitahal. Drug, I mean, it is obscene. But yet, you meet people that tell you,
well, you know, I'm undecided.
But I only have one vote. One vote. The one person I know who I can mobilize for sure to get to the polling station to vote for me in San Fernando West will be me. Because I'm in charge of myself. I figure my mother will come and vote for me too. Right? But the truth is this. It takes all of us. If we are convinced that you have a fair opportunity and somebody with some discipline and a plan, it takes everybody in this room the moral obligation, if you can associate yourself with our philosophy, to go out and bring 5 or 10 other people and ensure that they vote on election day. Because I tell you this, boy, if you want to meet a side of people who spent before the fact should start, it's the PM. Right now, boy, we win that already. You had nothing to worry about, you know. You had nothing in the bag. You win it that hands down. Don't worry about that, no. I am the type of fella to put my head down and run till I reach that finish line. And I stop when I show I'm way ahead of the game. So we have a long run to make. And I'm asking you for your support. I'm asking you to give Nicole, call up all your friends, you know, in La Brea. Give her the support. Give Terry Jadoonanan the support. If ever you get a chance just to pass outside anywhere in Oropouch East, stop in a place that you don't know, sit down and talk to people and say, boy, that money lad or something else, eh? Don't tell them what you're really doing, eh? You have to get there subtly, right? You have to convert subtly. So, you know, you find that Terry Jadoonanan is a nice fella. Yeah. And he's kind of cute, you know. Say that about Terry. You won't be lying. But the truth is, that's what is necessary for us to get up to the US level of simple talk about honesty and hard work and getting back to basics, you know? That's where we need to be. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Yes, we have one here.
Okay, we take this question and come to you.
Yes, good evening. Thanks for being here. This question is for my MP, Ms. Nicole Alvera. Yes. So, before I ask you the question, right? How many of y'all might have took a drive down to Library and went to the pitch league and really, you know, had a good observation of the place?
How many of y'all did that recently?
Right. And in your honest opinion, I want y'all to tell me your honest, honest opinion about the constituency of Library in terms of. It's terrible. Impressive. It's very, it's just that. So, Ms. Nicole Oliver, I want to know what is your strategic plan for the people of Library as our new upcoming candidate. You have my support, by the way. Yes.
No, well, development of Lubbers is really centered around the Union Industrial Estate. Our vision really is to have the Union Industrial Estate as the next point leases. Now, you all would know that it was PNM government that would have developed the point leases industrial estate. PNM has been the only government to really develop all the industrial estates in this country. So industrialization. Let me recognize that the point leases estate was approaching capacity back in 1994. He created a little bit co-industrial estate and we put some factories there. But then recently, in just before 2010, as part of the aluminum smelter project, together with the Trinidad Generation Unit, the United Industrial Estate was created as the new site for industrial development in this nation. So that really would be the solution for the lack of economic activity in the whole Southwest Peninsula. If we look at the constituencies of Superior, that's Superior. Faisalabad and Point Fortin. Well, Superior would also get some benefit from it. The highway to Point Fortin, that is all part of the development of the Union Industrial Estate, because when you create greater industrial activity within that location, you would need the transportation systems to bring the people in to and also work for the community. So the Union Industrial Estate really is the backbone of the development for the constituents, but it's not the only thing. Because the main problem in the constituency really is job creation and economic activity. Tourism is another area in which we really are looking to develop. Now there's a lot of scope for tourism within that constituency. There is energy tourism. We
We are the home of the world's first producing hot oil well. The very first oil well to be drilled in the world was drilled within Liberty constituency. The very first successful oil well was also drilled in the constituency. Now Trinidad has been involved in commercial oil production for over 100 years. Back in 2008, as a nation, we celebrated 100 years of commercial oil production. So we have been in the business of commercially selling oil longer than Texas. So that is something that is of historical significance for the energy industry internationally. And the very first producing oil well, I mean, the site, the location is known, is identified, but it hasn't really been developed as a heritage site. So energy tourism is an excellent form of tourism that we can develop. We also have a lot of historic sites within the constituency. We have a lot of beaches on both ends of the constituency, but you can never access them because there are no roads to access them. But there's some lovely little niche beaches, some very nice cozy areas where you can go and just, instead of the commercial type Maracas type beach, if you just want a nice private country beach, where you can see a mangrove in the background, you can have a nice cozy area. We have a lot of those things, but most of them are not accessible because there are no roads to go to them. So developing all those tourism and agriculture was always a big thing in the constituents. Cocoa and coffee, as in my grandfather on my mother's side, came from Grenada and had a cocoa and coffee estate. I mean, we all know about the history of cocoa in Trinidad and Tobago. Now, when the oil industry started, because they found oil in areas which were in close proximity to the cocoa estates, and everyone in the south, because oil was paying more money, they just stopped farming cocoa and coffee and went in the oil industry. But it is well known that the local variety of cocoa is a very high value product. So there's a lot of room for re-establishing agriculture in the constituency. Palaseco Enterprises, PSA, Palaseco Agricultural Enterprises Limited, they own a lot of agricultural real estate within the constituencies, but in recent years they have not been developing. Instead, the government has been using them, because this is a state enterprise that's owned by Petrotrin. The government has been using them to repair roads within the Safari constituency instead of maintaining that agricultural development. By the primary school that I went to, there was this huge orange field. I remember as a child, they would tell us, don't pick the orange. I went into the school road as recently, 5 years ago I went in, and there was not a single orange tree. Because with the change of the government, they've totally abandoned all the agricultural practices within the constituency. There's no cocoa and coffee, there's no orange, there's no citrus. The tea plantations are just being left, there's no replanting. So industrial development, tourism, agriculture, another one of the areas on which we really focus is sports. Liberty constituency has a huge tradition in sports. We had several members in the strike squad from 1990. You all remember the road to Italy?
Yeah.
A number of those players came from Liberty constituency. But right now we do not have any, I didn't want to say world class, any suitable facility for professional football. Cameron Jones' father lives with the constituency. Akeem Adams, you see the field where close to where he lived in Slazzy Trace. That field is in a totally deplorable state. You have cows grazing on the field. The Palaseco Velodrome, I don't know how many of you all would know, but the cyclists among us probably remember the Palaseco Velodrome is one of the premier cycling tracks in the Caribbean back in the 60s and 70s. Premier cycling track. I went into that velodrome over Easter weekend and I literally cried when I saw that they had allowed a backhoe to drive over the cycling track to do some work on the field. And you can see the gorges on the cycling track, the tunnel to enter the stadium area. There's fish living in there. How could a tunnel to go in a stadium get to a stage where it's so filled with water that there are fish comes actually living in the tunnel? So you see, what we have seen is that under this government, you've seen a lot of existing facilities in areas that are not supporters of the partnership. All those facilities have been left just to deteriorate beyond anything that's imaginable. So So those are some of the areas I'm going to try and be working on.
Thank you. Excellently done. Next question, please. I know we had about three at the back there, but itching to get across it.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Hi, good night, everyone. Clean or assurance, and that. I mean, I'm listening to everything you're saying, and I mean, it's sounding great. I know, I'm happy, excited about it, but all I'm asking is that, you know, people treat politics as a business. And I'm asking now if it's possible that y'all can treat it as a treat us as like your children, because we are under you, and what you say you did like directed everything for us. And I'm asking that today, speaking to you, that you actually think that where we want to reach in life, where we want to do our steps ahead, that you actually put that in place. So we don't just study and I'm in power, let me fat my pockets, let me, you know, do what I have to do. Let me see now that, all right, be proud of my country. Be happy where I'm living. Let me build this country to a place that I could laugh and smile and be the person that I am. Because which country, you know, that somebody when you're in big city or tomorrow, you have a holiday. I mean, you have this for this country to think about. So I'm just asking that you give it up. I told you actually take time and take it from you. That's what I'm asking.
Well done. Just look at that here. Dr. Rowney is a no-nonsense man. If you go home to where Keith Rowney lives, you will see that he lives in a place that somebody on his salary could have afforded. You go by any member of the PNM and you will understand that there is a link, a rare link, between what they earned previously and where they are presently. There is no magic pumpkin and peas patch that builds our homes. Seriously. Despite all the allegations you've heard against the PNM, you've never heard it. Save for the case of Johnny O'Halloran, and I wasn't even born yet, right? You've never heard it about a sitting PNM MP. If I wanted to fatten my pocket, I wasn't going into politics. Simple. I believe that I had to have done whatever I had to do before to be in a position where I could have afforded to give up some time to do that. That's the way that I've approached it. But why I started with Dr. Rowley being a no-nonsense man is that he will not and could never, by his life's work, tolerate corruption amongst PNM ministers or PNM persons. I can tell you that from what I know of him personally. The way that I view it is from my own professional background. If I'm your lawyer and you're my client, I have a fiduciary relationship where I am obliged to look after your interests because you trust me to look after your interests. And that same fiduciary relationship will continue into this relationship. My simple reason, as is Terry's, as is Nicole's, for doing this, like our colleagues Stuart Young and I go through these moments of panic, both of us, because we're both very strong in our legal practices, and we have our offices just literally just a building apart from each other, and Stuart will freeze and come over by me, and I have clients in my office. I shouldn't really be saying this, right? I have clients in my office, and my secretary say, Mr. Rawi, Mr. Young is here to see, and I go outside and he grab me and give me a hug. He say, Faris, boy, you think we're crazy? Or we'll get through this? Am I committing financial suicide? And I say, Stuart, yes, you are committing financial suicide, but you do it for the right reason, because we both know that we're doing this because we have children that we really want to have the ability to grow up in our country the way we did. Half of me is Iraqi, half of me is Trinidadian. I grew up seeing the Middle East in a place that I thought was magic. In Iraq, as you're driving down the highways in the 1980s, how we have walkover bridges by Karani. They had moving escalators in the middle of the desert. I could not imagine so much wealth I watched it all crumble because people didn't step up to the plate and do what was required. So you have to come to a point where you're prepared to stop and say, well, hold on, I'm going to give my part. Junior Regrello did his part. I'm doing my part. Terry's doing his part. Nicole is doing her part. It wasn't easy for any of us to decide to do this. But here's where we return it to you now and say we hope that you too will step up and do your part, not by your vote alone, but by participating, if even only necessarily from the neck up. It takes everybody in their communities to stop and lend a hand and to participate one way or the other. It's important for us to hold each other accountable. And let me tell you, what matters the most, I'm sure my colleagues will immediately agree when I say this. After you have some biting criticism, which you get occasionally, see when you go on a walk and a whole lady puts her arms around you and hug you up and say, son, I'm praying for you. May the blood of Jesus cover you from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. Let me tell you, you feel like you just get an injection of energy because it really takes just a little bit of positivity in all of that negativity to make it better. So we give you that assurance for sure, but we want you to remember it is a reciprocal arrangement and it doesn't hurt every now and then to tell your MP, oh God, fellas, we'll keep on fighting now. Not just at election time, but during the run. And we are going to break that mold where people tell everybody, yeah, when they come, I've seen you once now. Let me see how many times in 5 years I'm going to see you. We're going to break that mold.
Yeah.
I'm going to some questions on that as well. Yes.
Okay, and I'm going to deal with the appeal government workers who like to pull the country to ransom. When did
no, I'll clearly have to answer that one.
Yeah, because it's like over a year since you put in for income tax. I know they were protesting and still haven't received anything. Also, like the nurses, teachers, you know, all those who like to pull the country to ransom.
That's an incredible question. Okay, so let me give you a little unknown PNN history. You just spoke about managing the labor sector and managing the unions. So there's private sector, government sector, and labor. A tripod. One leg fall, everybody falls. In this government cycle, they boast a fellow named Errol MacLeod, who has the distinction of being the worst member of parliament in the history of Point of Pain. He came to Parliament and bust a big boost. Oh, by the way, he came to Parliament once and said, there is a PNM fellow. He's a lawyer. He's the public relations officer. Every Monday morning and every day on television, claims he has a master's degree. But I know he doesn't have one. Yeah? That's how he's talking. I'm listening to this man in my office one while he's talking. I said, but wait now, it's me talking about it. I look behind my desk, I see my master's certificate, I take it off the wall, I pick up my King's College magazine with my name on it, I go down to the Parliament and I confronted him. He was coming out of the chamber. Watch me. I say, Mr. MacLeod, you better not have been talking to me. Will you? He looked at me. I say, well, anyway, just because it's you, and I want to confront you personally. Look my master's certificate here. And look the alumni magazine with my name in it here. So if any man, all the man you say you are, go and apologize. He never apologized. Same way, he came now to the Parliament and said that they had settled the most number of wage negotiations in the history of Trinidad. I went to the registry of the industrial court and I pulled down the wage negotiation settlements under the PNM. And you know what? They have barely scratched one-tenth of what we did in a five-year period. But they can lie. Lie like it's going out of style. And what you don't realize is how successful wage negotiation was managed under the PNM. And this is an answer to your question. we had something called the Public Sector Negotiation Committee. In the last 5 years, you become accustomed to blue flu, green flu, immigration flu, police flu. Whoever vexes the flu and what's mutant is now a God anointed. Actually, what's year after year after year for 8 years straight, and it never once had a shutdown in Trinidad and Tobago. Never. We don't deserve applause, you know. What we deserve is to get some handkerchiefs to wipe the tears now. Because from 2010 to 2015, every public sector wage negotiation has gone wrong, and the country has been held to ransom. And the reason is this bright government decided to scrap the Public Sector Wage Negotiation Committee. And you know what that public sector was? That committee was to make sure the left hand knew what the right hand was doing. So if you're going to raise wages over here, match it up with wages over here. But not these people. 15% over so and 2% over so. You must expect people to riot. So, fear not. We intend to return to normalcy. One of them is the Public Sector Wage Negotiation Committee. And by having relationships with people, we intend to approach them with open book philosophy to say, tell us how to pay you. Because what's more important is not just that you're getting a pension, but that your pension is indexed to inflation. As inflation rises, your pension should rise.
Yes.
Can't be fixed that you get a pension for $500 and now cost of living is at $1,500 and your $500 don't mean nothing. What you want to make sure is that it's sustainable. But we have a shrinking growth rate in Trinidad. Less young people working the mine, more older and aging people. So these are the things that we have to open the books on and ask the unions, this is our true situation, tell us how to do it. Do you want to have surgery with a knife that is a scalpel, or do you want a spoon to cut it out? This choice will have to be up to union in coordination with the government. And you have to be honest, and that's where reality is going to have to step in, and fairness must be the order of the day. There are many of us that work for the industrial sector. I work for them and against them. I usually work on it. In fact, the one man who I'm usually against in court and have big fight with is Stuart Young all the time. It's vicious ring-down fighting to the point where I tell him, Stuart, please don't take another case against me. People keep asking us, are you sure you're in the same political party? Or they're fighting each other in court this bitterly. But it's that serious when you take your views. So we intend to do it with coordinated conversation and with transparency. Next question.
Good night. My question is about sport. I wanted to know what the PNM's plan when they form the next government is in terms of sport and sport development. I know that in 2010, you know, we see it all the time, every time we come down the highway, the Toruba Stadium, which was intended to help develop athletes, you know, so that we can produce world standard athletes. And, you know, the perception is usually that if you are not good academically, if you show some potential in sport, then that, you know, people usually push you into that area. But I think that the field is a lot more varied than that, you know, in the different areas. So when we look at, for example, entrepreneurial and entrepreneurialism, you know, and developing, you know, entrepreneurs and that sort of thing, I think sport is a good avenue to look at, because there's like sport management, you know, there's sport law, and there are various areas in sport. And I wanted to know if there were any plans to look at that sector and to further develop it.
Sure. I can tell you, quick answer to that is, our plan for sport is not life sport. In other words, we don't plan on investing in something that is wildly scandalous. But sport is a whole sector of diversification as well. Dr. Rowley actually mentioned part of our philosophy on sport when he was talking about how Jamaica revolutionized their approach to the Olympics at track and field in particular, because collegiate sports day in Jamaica is the big thing. The fiercity of the competition at collegiate level is what breeds our big runners, our big winners. I mean, you just need to think Bolt, and you think of Bolt being a star while he was at school. So it has to be introduced into the school curriculum. I personally believe that you have to have a balance in your affairs. You never quite succeed in getting there. There are times when the pendulum swings one way or the other. But you really ought to have a balance between physical, mental, and spiritual. And getting sport and diet and nutrition into the school curriculum is going to be a crucial part of it. Because more and more you will recognize that people take their health seriously. We don't fit the body types of what our parents look like necessarily again. When you think about it, if you look at a 40-year-old today, 30-year-old, 20-year-old, we physically don't look like people that are 60 or 65 in the brackets ahead of us, because people have invested a lot more in their health and nutrition through a globalization process. That needs to be taken into the school environment, and one of our policies is to get that physically inside of there, and then try and carve out the entrepreneurial sides of it. My daughter plays squash for Trinidad, as an example. My other daughter is on the national team for gymnastics. I competed in karate for Trinidad for many, many years. So it's a passion of mine, physical activity. But that comes about through some rigorous training. Sport is beautiful, it helps you to understand the loose shape. Nothing worse than when you bust your tail on a court in front of everybody. Slip and slide. I mean, my daughter tells me that all the time. She said, Daddy, I lost all my shape. First time I took a slide across the squash court while I thought I was looking cute. Right? So, it's a wonderful thing, but it builds your stamina to succeed. So we are very committed to it, but we're very attracted to the entrepreneurial side of it. That's where physical trainers enter the system. That's where nutritionists enter the system. We're sport burgeons. So we're very committed to it, big part of our plans. Question is operationalizing it as well. That's where our playgrounds and recreation centers become the after home environments as well. That's where converting our basketball courts into more than just basketball courts, but administrative sport complexes makes a big difference. We can do so much more with our basketball courts if we put them three stories high and enclose them. Mm-hmm. We did gymnasium facilities. Upper floor could be homework supervision. Next floor could be Pilates. It could be gym. It could be aerobics. It could be cycling. Next floor could be basketball, small goal, rain or shine, day or night. That's what we need to start talking about. Basketball courts that turn off the lights at night become scary places. They should be able to be multifunctional. And that's what we are committed to. And every open space and area for us is one more area we can do that in. We have two more questions. The next question is from Imtiaz Ahmed.
Good night. Next three MDs. Go on, pick the line. Alright, sorry to tell you, but you have to pass the mic up. Then we go on and Terry. With 3.5 weeks ago, we all on the same team here, so we want to know what you guys plan to do to ramp up your team, ramp up your campaign, to get everybody in the zone. How are you going to bring everybody together so we will pull off your two seats as well?
That's where we need to call our campaign managers. Faris is absolutely right. That ball falls in the campaign manager's court. What I'm doing to wrap up that is attend meetings like these. For those who are not aware of who I am, you all know and not spread out from. Next week, after our launch on Saturday, nomination day is Monday. From Tuesday, in my constituency, I'll be having three meetings per week. Increase walkabout from a bit earlier. We usually start at 5 to 7, but now we'll be starting at around 3 o'clock. So, I mean, it all depends on my campaign manager person. And if anybody knows Harry Ravenham, that says it all. So, best campaign manager.
Terrence.
Competition. But it will help a lot to have combined meetings with San Fernando West, San Fernando East, because we bought each other. So, I mean, that will put a lot of people together so they can actually get the exposure in Urubuchi so they can actually take our seat in the front. Right.
Now, I'm looking at my fellow candidates here, and we actually represent three different types of constituencies. So, my constituency, what he has, is slightly harder fight than the rest of us. Faris is fighters. It's a hard fight. But I'm pleased to say that, that my fight really is not as hard as it is for these two gentlemen. However, no, but what we will be doing for the next couple of weeks to wrap up the campaign is, well, starting tomorrow, we're going to start having public meetings. So, first one will be in Sogo Village, so that starts at 7, and, well, on Saturday is the presentation of candidates. Sunday, I have a little time off, but from Monday morning, nomination day, from Monday afternoon, for the next 2 weeks, I'm having between 7 and 9 meetings a week. That means on some nights I'll be having 2 meetings a week. So that's how we will be seriously wrapping up. Next week, Saturday, well, in order to mobilize the youth, we have a 7-a-side football competition. So it's an idea that we actually got from... So we are borrowing your idea. And we're going to have a huge mobilization, so it's going to be a big 7-a-side football competition. Because, well, again, what we realize is the youth really have not been that engaged. Now, I'm walking with persons who are significantly elder than myself. And when you go into a home, you see the grandmother comes out, and there's almost no young people inside the house, but they're looking outside and they're seeing a bunch of old people in P&M jerseys, so they have absolutely no interest. So I got some youth to them and I said, look, I need you all to start walking with me, because youths are not going to come out if they're not seeing youths on the field as well. But the youths who are running the youth mobilization aspect of it, I give them full autonomy. I told them anything you want to do, you do it on your own. You don't have to seek any permission or authorization from any of the elder heads in the campaign team. See, I'm giving you that power, you go ahead, you do your thing, you get your youths together, you bring your youths. Last week, Sunday, we had a nice little family day and sports event where we got a lot of youths together. And next week, Saturday, is our next big mobilization event. At the end of the month for independence, we actually have, we have a couple of big rallies planned for independence. Now, my constituency is unique in the sense that it actually has two halves. There's the north half of Lumbre constituency and the south half. Because in the middle of the constituency, we're actually separated by a forest reserve. So if you're going from one end to the next, you're actually passing through a large area with no houses. And on both sides of the constituency, you have different personality types, different characteristics. So I actually have multiple campaigns being run. So for Independence Weekend, we have a series of motorcades. On the 30th, we have a motorcade that starts in Santa Fe, in the southern end, and moves across to the northern end, and we'll have a big rally and a family on the northern end. And on Independence Day itself, we reverse. So we start at the northern end, move across to the southern end, and have that big rally and a family there. So everything we do, we have to do in duplicate. But at least that is helping us to really get a widespread mobilization.
San Fernando West will not get that easy. My campaign starts with guilt. All of them better come out and support me. Every man, Jack. I tell you here, I come in to check everybody finger personally on the election day, and I want to know by 8 o'clock in the morning everybody home. Must be this long line mass exodus, right? So we want to set a record for being the earliest constituency to be declared. Because we are going to do it. The financial side of my campaign is Imtiaz Ahmad, who is always precise. So he says it 3.5 weeks. Oh God, Imti. I counting it in 3 Sundays. You had to remind me how long it really is.
Yeah, I counted money.
This every day we count it on, but the truth is this. We have an exciting campaign in San Fernando. It has been filled with so many young people that it's unreal, but it's been filled with so many older people who are really young people that it's unreal. I mean, Bobby, and I always hesitate as to whether to call him Uncle Bobby or not, has gray hair and can run as fast as me. You have to see this man running with a cigarette in his hand. While you running and keeping pace with me. We've had Devin, we've had Jody. No, Jody doesn't get up here. Too messy in different walkers, the computers. We have the 2 BIPTA girls. We have everybody. I mean everybody. Zarius, who is the speedy man in the campaign. Chelsea, who's all of 17 years old, can't vote. She'll be voting if she could. But her birthday is just after the election. So we've had so many young people come on board who can't even vote, but working in the campaign. So ladies and gentlemen, it's about volunteerism. And if we could beg you to get volunteerism out there in Urbuch East, in La Brea, in San Fernando West, San Fernando East, wherever it might be, please. There's a reason why we have that tagline in the PNM these days, all hands on deck. And I'll end on that question by saying, you will note we have the rocking best campaign song that Trinidad and Tobago has heard. And that Isasha song, coupled with Peter C's song, on music alone, we deserve to win the election. So make sure you come. I mean, every time I feel tired and I'm running and I hear Isasha singing about it, I get a little step in my going with me. So it's going to be fun. 3 more Sundays. Forgive me for counting it that way. 3 more Sundays to go. You better come out. You better be part of it. If you really want to get a little fit on the campaign, San Fernando West welcomes you. We have a wonderful running campaign. So you're welcome to come. Our photographer, our videographer is testimony to that. Every time he sees me, goes the running candidate. I go, yes, sir. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your participation this evening. We have 2 small but important events to now just attend to. They are for our participants in our surveys. So we have our 3rd week participant. I'm not sure if she's here because she said that she would come, but we didn't track to see if she actually did. It's Denise Joseph. I'm not sure if Denise is here. If she's not, then she indicated that she will contact us after. So she participated. She was our 3rd week winner. But we have our grand prize winner. And our grand prize winner, who is the overall, now I have to get this name pronounced correctly, Faris Al-Rawi. Faris Al-Rawi is our grand prize winner of an iPhone 6. That's what I'm going to do for And if Faris can join us for a moment, and yes, ladies and gentlemen, it's not staged. She is really this good looking and genuinely won all by herself. So Faris, this is your voucher for your iPhone 6. Thank you for participating and for winning. And for just by chance being as pretty as you are, for making the PNM look good. We sincerely appreciate all your participation. And we hope that with your iPhone 6, you will bombard at least 1,000 people on election day. By WhatsApp, by Twitter, by Instagram, by Facebook, by any messages you can. And get them to come on. Thank you sincerely. God bless Jody for keeping me on the right track. Just to note that it was donated by friends of the PNM from Miami. So we just want to say a special thank you to them for their donation. And ladies and gentlemen, if ever you wanted to find somebody with a handbag as large as a tent, there's Jody. If you need a stretcher, if you need shoes, if you've got an extra bed, that you perhaps need Jim. Somewhere, Jody has it in her handbag. So she's welcoming all the people that need assistance, okay? Ladies and gentlemen, we're free to mingle. Please leave tonight having met someone that you never met before. And remembering their name, please. And please also, well, I was for donating the gifts for our female guests tonight. So they're in bags by the door. And
Sasha.
There are a few Sasha cosmetics, obviously. And that comes from no less a hand we know than Mrs. Kamala Regrello, who is the lion champion of coordinating what is otherwise a very difficult area for the PNM. And she has not only given us that support, but she's given us Joshua Regrello, in particular, who's played at so many of our events and spoken for us, and the lesser known of the Regrellos, Junior Regrello, who has been side by side with us on this campaign from day one, endorsing us all the way. Thank you very much, all of you. So ladies and gentlemen, mix a little while, mingle a little while, and don't forget to meet somebody that you haven't met before. Thank you very much. God bless you all. And don't be an M.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
Faris, two voters right there.
Two voters right there. One and one potential. God bless you. Congratulations on your baby again. Take care.
Bye, Mom.
I'm